Thank you. Thank you all very, very much. I sure appreciate that. And let my first words be to Brendan. He's doing God's work. I tell you, he is doing God's work. And anyone here who can help him will be able to share in the great blessings that come from being an outspoken champion of the unborn. I am delighted to be here. Many of you may have heard me before, but one of the great privileges I have in this life is to talk to young people. I've had many opportunities to be on the media and to deal with the Wolf Blitzers in the world and to debate the liberals, and I've enjoyed that thoroughly, but nothing better than coming home to young people, whether it be left or right, on college campuses, which I think is truly the future of our country, to be able to reach them and touch them and to be here amongst you all who share many of my views. And I must say that I talk to people of my generation, and they're extremely concerned about this country. They're worried that we're on our last legs, that there is no way to expect it to be turned around, at least certainly not in their lifetime. But I tell them how I'm on college campuses, and I meet and talk to people such as you, and meet people like Brendan, who are out there fighting the battle. They have not given up, and that's the key. That's the key. I mentioned, remember, my brother is the half-full member of the family, and I'm the half-full, and he's the half-empty member of the family. He's a great American, my brother Pat, and I have many brothers, 7 brothers and a sister, and they're all great. But in this particular incident, Pat wrote an article, and it was worried. He had great concern. He figured, this is it. I don't see how things can turn around after this horrible decision of the president or whatever it was. And I called him up, and I said, Pat, I understand why you're concerned. I understand why you're worried, but I got to tell you something. You can't call the game. You can't call it. It's not over until we get off the field. And I, for one, am not getting off the field. We've been on the field a long time. We get knocked down and dirtied and kicked, and we feel as if it's time to just give it up. But we get up. We get up again, and we fight because they cannot beat us until we don't get up. And that is never going to happen. And that's what this conservative movement is about. We stay in the battle, even how tough it might be. He, of course, agreed with me, and he had to just be called, but he was in one of those low moments, and he has fought his whole life. What I want to talk to you all today about is something that is very dear to my heart. I know that you all have the passion. I know it's there. I know that the ability to turn this country around is with you all. I know it. I've met too many of you not to be extremely optimistic. But you all have to know how it's done. You have to kind of figure it out. And I think many of you have come to these conferences, specifically today, to kind of get a little more sense of what it is to be a leader, to talk to other leaders in this country, in this movement. And what I'm here to tell you is how to do it. How you can know that you'll be ready when it's your turn to make a difference, whether it be in your family or in your community or with your friends and colleagues, or with the country. You'll be ready, and that's what I'm here to talk about. You know, you look around the country, and as I said, there's many of us who are discouraged, how quickly it's tumbled towards a place where we never dreamed. You know, I just heard on this morning, on coming in, I guess they've arrested some woman who allowed her 7-year-old to walk a half mile alone to the swimming pool. They've arrested her. And a caller called in and said, that's interesting, because we have mothers and parents who are putting kids on trains 1,000 miles to illegally come into this country, and our government is talking about how we should reunite them with their parents. Nothing to do, but we're going to arrest this lady here because she sent her kid. And the policeman said, well, there's abusers, child abusers in the neighbor, you know, in this plant was adamant. Well, why don't the police do their job and arrest those guys and not worry about the mother who's sending her child down the street a half a mile? It is amazing where we've come to. It's all turned on its head. We have Homeland Security, all right? Homeland Security. That's the name of the department releasing thousands of criminal aliens into our communities. including child abusers, all right? They're releasing rapists, murderers, because they say, well, we can't really hold them any longer. Well, come on, guys. Surely Homeland Security and all the power of this U.S. government can figure out a way from keeping criminals from being released into our communities. If you can't do that, give it up, okay, and let someone else take charge. The American people should expect no less than Homeland Security doing everything in its power to keep the homeland secure and safe for our families and our children. That is their job. And so now the immigration issue has come to a full swing. We have all kinds of issues arising from this irresponsibility of a government refusing to enforce our laws, and a president who's taken it even further than that and has said, okay, we won't send any of the children back. They basically have amnesty. And establishing that as a presidential position, executive order. And so what happens? Thousands, tens of thousands of children coming across because they'll be allowed to stay. And so what he does? He asks for more money to pay for the lawyers of the children. That's what we're going to do. We're going to get them lawyers to make certain their rights are established. Meanwhile, who's paying for all of this? We're not worried about the fact that many of them have illnesses and diseases. Communities are terrified of having these individuals entered into their communities for no reason of ill will, but because they're worried about their families and their children going to school with someone who might have TB, a disease that we don't have any concern about here in this country now, but we may well soon have that concern. And so what does the president do? 60,000 this year, we're expecting 150 next year. You would think this would be a full court press to stop the 150 and to solve the problem so no one else comes, and then let's see what the best way to handle the 60 is. We might have differing views, but at least we address it as a national government, because all of America considers this the number one issue. We might want to have a president of the United States that looks at it and comes up with a plan and meets with the leaders of Congress and says, and the law enforcement officers of the country and says, what can we do? We can't have this. I may have made a mistake here. Maybe we can, turn this around somehow. No, he basically says, the word's out, that he's going to give them all the amnesty, and he goes about to return onto one more vacation. It is a president that doesn't care. He doesn't care. He has his own agenda, and the rest doesn't matter to him. And so we are faced a truly, truly frightening national tragedy on the border today. And you have Rick Perry, a man that's shown real courage, who's decided to put the National Guard on the border. That is a first step. That is a man that I respect, who takes that position and says, state of Texas, that's what I'm responsible for, the people here in Texas, nobody in the national scene will take care of this border. Let me see what I can do to make certain I protect the people for whom I'm in charge. That is a leader. That is a leader. That is extremely strong and courageous decision on his part. Before we can consider him as a candidate for 2016, he's got to work on his debate skills. But other than that, the man has quite a bit to offer. So where are we today when you look at all that's happening? And I know you've heard from many other speakers about what's out there. So let me just talk about things that I'm concerned about that I think are playing a role in why we are faced with this disaster we are today. And that is a hesitancy on the part of too many over the last 20 years, this political correctness, maybe it's even 25 years now, this idea that we should be hesitant and cautious about the words we use and the positions we take because we could offend. You know, we could offend people. Well, I don't know why you'd be offended by some of the things I say. I don't really give a hoot whether you're offended or not, quite honestly, because I've looked at these issues and I've considered them seriously, and I feel I have a very strong argument that these positions in which I take are in the best interest of this nation, and no one is going to make me hesitate or be cautious. Too many of our good, strong conservatives have backed away from issues that were too controversial because we want to build this kind of a unified front and reach to more and more Americans. And if we come out too strong on some of these issues, we'll offend people. What kind of leadership is this? We're not talking in policy. Sure, when you get into Congress, you're hammering out a bill. You might have to give a little. You might have to take a hope for more, fight for more. You might not get everything you want. But when you're making a national case to the nation on the national forum about what you think is right, where you think the country should go, what you believe, what your principles are. There's no place for hesitancy. There's only a place for boldness, to be clear and absolute about what you believe. That's being an American, and that's what I want to talk about today. When you've heard so much, and this is a story I tell often, you've heard so much about leaders in our state capitals, the leaders in our national capital. They're right here in Washington, our leaders. You know, the press writes about them, you know. I think they use the term way too broadly, because most of the people in this town are not leaders. I'm pleased to tell you that I see the number climbing, in my personal opinion. But when you think about things such as a simple concept of party line vote, you know, that's when word comes down, this is Republicans vote Republican, Democrats vote over here no, because they're Democrats, yes for Republicans. Your leadership calls your office and says, party line, it's a party line, it's a party line. Yes, yes, this is what you have to vote, yes, it's a party line. So what happens is a piece of legislation comes down, and you're a congressman, and word is, yes, party line. Well, what kind of leader is that? That's cheap. You're getting the word from the top how to vote. You might want to say, excuse me, would it be all right if I read the bill? Maybe I could study the bill, see if it applies, see if it's in what I believe would be good legislation, which would be solid, which would reflect the principles I believe in and ran on, and those things I spoke to my constituents about. And maybe I should make this decision because I'm a leader and I'm here as a representative of the people of my district or state. No, party Boehner or the president, if you're a Democrat, have put the word out. This is the way you vote. So you do it. That's not a leader. And that's why we're in the trouble we are. Do you know when a few Republicans decide, no, not going to go that route, they get chastised. They're threatened with possibly losing their fancy offices and maybe fundraising, and we might get somebody to primary you. I mean, this is big time. There's a lot of threats. This is enormous pressure to do what the party tells you to do. And that's why we are in the mess we are today. If we had independent, strong leaders in every one of those seats up there in which the Republicans hold, then we would have, sure, it wouldn't be as smooth and everybody organized, and the leader of the party, the person who's the speaker, would have a little more trouble on his hands. But hey, this is America, and we have a good debate, a vibrant debate, and our country sees that they're well represented. Somebody's out there fighting for them. That's what America wants. They want to see that their leaders are there for them. They're not going to win every time. They know that. But they had somebody there doing their battle. Okay? That's what it's about. Not afraid to discuss the issue of immigration because people will call me a racist and that'll be bad. I have to defend myself. And I can't have that in my general election. And so let's not talk about it. Let's do nothing. Let's let people come across illegally year after year after year until there's 15 to 20 million illegal people in the country, and now it's a crisis. And there's still, oh my gosh, it's so controversial, we don't know what to do here. And now we've got the children, and we got a poll to see how we're going to respond. You know, because they are children, and a case could be made that we're being hard-hearted if we say send them back. And so what going to we do? What do the polls say? What is all this? We can't run a country and be a successful, strong, powerful nation with people who first check polls before they decide which way to move. All right, this comes from your heart. This comes from your heart, from a clear understanding of what you believe, who you are, and where you think the country should go. Then you have that, you can fight to move it in that direction. So let's talk about how you do that. You debate. You all are in a perfect place. You are where you need to be to begin this process. Because most of you are on college campuses with most of the people around you in full disagreement with what you believe. It's perfect. So, I'd like to use the pro-life argument. Now, if life isn't your thing, that's fine. You still can be a leader. And you may want to choose, maybe the war, how these wars were transpired. Maybe it's trade. Maybe your issue is immigration. It doesn't matter. So just substitute for whatever it is that you are now starting to feel some interest, some real drive, that's the issue that really motivates you. I am an advocate for the unborn in any opportunity I have. But I'm very, very strong on immigration. I will talk trade with you. I'm not a free trader, so many of you will disagree with me. I don't mind. We have a vibrant discussion. I'll tell you why I'm not a free trader any day of the week. These are issues that are very close to me. Size of government is another one. So you pick yours, but let's talk about life, for instance, because it's such a good one on college campuses. You say you're pro-life. I say to you, are you certain? If someone came to you and said, gosh, I've got a terrible situation, I was raped, I found myself pregnant, I don't know what to do, I need help, I don't want to tell my folks, it'll destroy them. Are you certain what you would do? Are you absolutely certain what you'd do? Okay, so let's talk about how you become certain. You know, you go into a class. Well, the first thing is you could take a small group. Maybe that was where you want to start. A small group that you know, a roommate, maybe a group at lunch that you know are pro-choice. And you say, you know, how can you possibly be pro-choice? How can you possibly? Every single time a life is taken. And you know when you do that, they're going to look at you and they're going to say something that's going to be ugly and make you feel uncomfortable. How is it possible that you would support a government that forces a 14-year-old raped by her dad to have a child? What kind of person are you that would force that poor girl to have that child? And you're like, oh, whoa, I don't know if I'd force that child. Oh, no, this is not good. How did I get into this debate? I don't even know what I'm thinking to even raise this issue. Okay, you're not ready. What else is new? None of us are when we first begin the process. So you go back and you talk to some people, your pro-life friends, some conservatives. What do you think about this issue? This is a tough one. If you come to me, I'm going to be very, very blunt with you. I say that is their best position. That is their strongest argument. But for me, every single child is exactly that, unborn child. And I cannot pick and choose which of these children will live and die. I want nothing to do that. I have never been given authority to that. I fight for the life of every single child. But there are good conservatives who will say, ah, rape and incest. I really am uncomfortable with that. I believe the law should allow that exception. So you're an exception. That's fine. You got to figure out who you are. That's what's key. Because in a debate, when the limelight is on you, you're tense. You got five people telling you that you're completely crazy, that you are an extremist, an anti-feminist, and whatever other ugly thing they want to come up with. You have to know what you believe. Not what your parents told you, not what something you heard, not something I said. What is it you believe? So you go back and you talk to some people and you make this decision. You talk to some people on both sides and then you say, no, I'm certain it's a child. If I know it's a child, I have to fight for all the children. That's my position. Let's move on. Then you go back. Now you're comfortable when they hit you with the first round. So what are they going to say next? You're going to have some of your own armor too, you know? What about the child that's viable in the womb at now, what is it, 5.5 months or so? What about that? Maybe even 5 months. Do you think they should be able to, you tell that to a pro-choicer. The baby is viable. You think it's okay to go in and knock it off before it's born? Is this okay? Put them on the defensive a little bit. Let's get them kind of nervous. And they're going to hit you again with something. I'm telling you, I've spent 25 and 35 years now debating liberals. They never have more than 2 good rounds. Just hang in there. You can win. You can beat a liberal. I tell you, just hang in there. The key is for you to start feeling comfortable with their position. Read a little bit. What do they think? How are they thinking? When I'm called up by CNN and said, we want you to talk guns this afternoon, I don't just head on down there and talk Second Amendment. I want to know what they're saying today. What's their strongest argument? So when I hear it and the cameras are going, I'm like, yep, I already figured this one out. I'm coming back with this. You know, I already know what they're going to say. And that's why you talk to people who disagree with you. It doesn't have to be an angry conversation. It may turn into that. They may end up calling you names. What do you care? Okay, you're trying to find out what is the best, who am I? What do I believe? What is it they think? Are they right on some of these issues? Let me hear it from them. And you go through this process. You go back and you go back. And then if you're truly pro-life, you think, you know, it is a child. You know, whether you're exceptions or not, it's still a child. And most abortions, of course, have nothing to do with rape or incest. So you go back and then you look for an opportunity. I'm telling you, math class, I don't care, history class, sociology, whatever it is. You wait for an opportunity for somebody to raise the issue of abortion, Roe v. Wade, choice, anything. And you say, you know, I'd like to make a point here. This is a terrible, terrible policy. Every single time a child's life is taken, that's about all you'll get out. You may want to go a different direction and say, there's two victims every time. This is terrible for the mother and the child. Whatever position it is that you feel passionate about, lay it out there. Then you'll have the whole class turn on you, and you will wish you had never said anything, because you'll see these people looking at you, sneering at you. You've probably already sensed this at times on campus. You'll have people talking about, how can you take that position? It's so backward, you Neanderthal. You know, that is the perfect moment. You feel that tension. You feel that anxiety building up, like, golly day, I wish I'd never said anything. That's the pressure. And when you feel the pressure and you feel it again and again, you realize, I have to be able to feel this pressure and go right through it. We call it the firestorm. Go through it. Go through it. Hold your own. The first time you might want to just not say anything more and go home and kind of take a cold shower and say, good, that's over, you know. But then you get up and you go back and you go back and you go back. Because I'm telling you, all of these congressmen and senators, they didn't come to this town, and those state legislators, they didn't go to their state capitals thinking, oh, when there's a party line vote, I'll just go along with it. I'm just going to be a go-along kind of guy. They expected to make a difference. They had issue or two that they really wanted to be, really accomplish something. And for those people that they knew were suffering as a result of certain policies, whatever it is that got them to run. But the pressure was too much. And that pressure is the same pressure you're going to feel when you have 18, 20, 30 people looking at you like you have lost your mind and you're a mean-spirited individual to even make such a rotten statement as you have. You need to know how that feels. And you need to think, good, watch this one if they think that was bad. And you come back again. You stand tall and you are bold and you make the statement that you know is true. And you don't let anyone pressure you to back away from that position. That turns you into a leader. You do it. You know what? I often will think, I can be as strong a pro-lifer. I can believe it fervently. I talk to people who've had abortions. I've seen how they feel as they discuss the impact it's had on their lives. But what good does all of this mean if I don't speak out amongst people who disagree? When you're in that math class or history class and you make that simple statement, people are going to look and they're going to think, oh my gosh, but there could be somebody in that room who has never heard somebody speak so passionately, so absolutely. And they're just going to register it, not say anything, never mention it to you. And 2 years from now, you don't know. You could save a life. You can save lives by speaking out. But you cannot do anything if you stay quiet. You know, I've often thought back. I was privileged to work with Ronald Reagan for many, many years. And I remember it was several months after he had recuperated from that attempted assassination. And I had the privilege of sitting next to him at a lunch. And he still had his soup and things. I said, hey, that looks pretty good. He said, I'll switch with you. You know, I had a big piece of chicken and gravy and potatoes. He said, my doc won't let me eat any of that, but I could just sneak yours over here. We could swap, you know. We were laughing. And I, of course, told him how pleased I was that, you know, that he had recovered fully and all. And he made a statement to me, and he said, you know, Bay, I know I'm on borrowed time. I know I'm on borrowed time. The Lord has preserved my life so I can do something he needs done. That's what it's all about. He knew that this job, being in the White House, being the President of the United States, was something that he basically was called to do, that he was the right person at the right time, and that he had put himself in a position to actually get there. You know, he prepared himself and had thought about it, and when he chose to run and he had won, he always recognized it as something that was in the Lord's plan. And he basically said that he had to do what he was there to do. didn't matter if anybody disagrees. It doesn't matter if the press called him names and said he was an outrage. What would that matter when you know you're doing what the Lord wants you to do? And as I've reflected on that over the years, I come to realize that the Lord has something for all of us to do. We all have certain strength. You all can reach people I can never reach. You have the ability to really change lives. But like Ronald Reagan, you got to prepare yourself. You got to prepare yourself. You got to make certain that you have the strength and the courage to do exactly what is meant to do when it comes your way. And I think that sometimes we think of leaders as people who are elected. But leaders are everywhere. They're all around us. We're leaders in families. Do you fight for your children? Do you know, in the community, in your workforce, in your schools? You can make a difference in people's lives every single day if you choose to do it. But it's not the easy path. It can be the tougher path. I think of what George Washington said. The sacred fire of liberty is in the hands of the American people. And that's not the corporations. That's not the rich and famous. That's not the elected officials. That's us. That's us. In the hands of the American people. And there's no qualifiers to that. It doesn't say, oh, when you're settled down and you have your condo and your car and your good job and you're married, now you need to do it. Oh, no. It's now. Let me tell you, friends, it is now, and we need every single one of you. We need you speaking boldly. You heard a little bit earlier, a movement. It's a movement. It's not about one big position and one leader. Ronald Reagan was elected as a result of a movement of one person telling another, did you see this guy? Have you heard him? You want to listen to him. And it was a prairie fire that spread across the country. It took 4 years. He lost in 76. And people started talking, and the buzz was out there. You can start that buzz. You can start it amongst your family and amongst your friends. You're part of this to create the movement and to move it further so that conservatism, again, is dominant in the country, and we can get the leaders we need to make this country great again. It's our obligation. It's our responsibility. Don't worry about complaining, oh, my gosh, those guys back in Washington did this or that. I learned very, very honestly that that's not the answer. Once I was out on the road defending, trying to derail a huge amnesty bill that George Bush had supported. And people, I was out traveling, talking to groups and on radio and TV. And people kept saying, why are they doing it? I voted for George Bush. Why are they doing this? I don't understand this. And I kept saying, well, you know, they believe in open borders. They believe in this. And finally I said, no, that's not the answer. The answer is what George Washington said. The answer is stop complaining and do something about it. This is our country. This is our great inheritance. It's our responsibility. If we don't like what Washington's doing, then we've got to turn it around. We don't allow it to continue. And that's why I ask and hope that each and every one of you will recognize that you can be a leader. But being a leader is to stand tall, to be proud, not to care if anybody says, oh my gosh, how could you possibly take a position like that on the issue of gay marriage? You just are a hateful person. Who cares what names they call us? If they can put you down, make you hesitate, make you cautious because of the names they can call you, my golly, get out of the arena. They will slaughter you before you ever get forward. You can't care about the names. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to quiet us. Forget about the names. Decide what it is. Who are you? What do you believe? Where do you think this country should go? How can you help move it there? Be firm, be certain, be bold. And as an American, recognize the great privilege you have to speak your mind, to know your heart is good and right, and that what you're saying is in the best interest of this country, whether everybody in the media disagrees, whether the people, your professors and college students disagree, it matters little. What is in your heart? Gain a passion for this nation. Love it dearly. Recognize people have died for it. They've put down their fortunes, everything they had, to give us what we have today. Are you ready to do the same? And I hope and pray each and every one of you recognizes tonight you're ready. You're ready to get into the arena. You're ready to build yourself up to that kind of person. So when it comes your way, you're ready to move the ball forward. And this is what I say. Thank you all very, very much. you. Thank you very, very much. Thank you very, very much. And let's have some questions here.
Hi, my name is Kaylee Long. I'm from College of the Ozarks in Branson, Missouri. Huge fan of yours, and I'm so thankful that you're here. You're like my role model, but.
Thank you very, very much.
And before I ask my question, I want to thank you so much for prioritizing the preservation of life and ending abortion, as it is probably the most successful and threatful offense to human life that we've ever seen. So I just appreciate your right priorities.
Thank you.
As you know better than I did, Ronald Reagan had such, he really exemplified the hegemony of the United States. He referred to it as the last stand on earth, a city on a hill, all of that. And he really cared about human life as whether it was Soviet, you know, US. In light of his vision and example that he painted of America, how do you think he would respond to our immigration crisis? I think we would all agree that you're right. Our first priority is to secure the border. But once that is done, we have children here who are children. How do we value and respect, show compassion, concern, and care for their natural rights, and at the same time really maintain, value our laws and continue to be a law-abiding country? How do we balance this?
It's an excellent question. And you must remember that Ronald Reagan said a country without borders is not a country.
Yeah.
You know, so you have to have to expect. Also, our country was founded, one of the real great principles on which our founding fathers relied is a fairness issue that, and a respect of law and order. You know, we can't have a society that doesn't respect the law or else chaos incurs, and that's where we are right now. We would have none of this problem. We would have none of this problem if there was the will and the courage in this state capital by our governments, this one and the past one, to enforce laws of the land. Just enforce the laws. We don't need any new laws. Just enforce the laws. Because what they are is, by saying, for instance, amnesty for all young people, people aren't dumb. So these people send all their young people now. All the young people. Can we allow unlimited number of young people to come into the country just because their circumstances are that there's difficulty, they're poor? Always we will have open doors to someone whose life is threatened and in that regard. But so let's go back to the specifics of the case. We've got to do something to immediately send the message to the Central American countries, stop. There's lots of things we could do. And we could make it a trade issue. All trade stops until you take care of these people. Now, until you stop sending them, until it stops. Another thing you could do is secure the border. I mean, there's many, many things we could do to discourage this. Secondly, which should be done on humanitarian as well as law abiding, laws enforcement of laws. The problem is this. If we give amnesty to 60,000, we will have 150,000 next year. That is just that's the situation. It's what happened when we gave amnesty under Ronald Reagan. We had 1 or 2 million, so we said, let's give them amnesty and change the law so nobody can legally hire. Well, we didn't enforce the law. We gave amnesty. Now we have 15 to 20 million. All right. Mm-hmm. Then he says a couple years ago, amnesty for young. Now we have 60,000, okay? We can't keep this up. So I think your compassion is something that each individual must open their heart to others. But that's not policy. Policy is, what is in the best interest of this nation? How do I protect this nation from diseases, from crime, from many, many costs that are not, that we can't afford, our communities can't afford, from good schools collapsing because of the enormous number of people coming in. So I think that's what the government has to do. And right now, I think there's a good case. Many of the kids are from, first of all, many of them are not kids. Well, that has to be taken care of. But I think if we closed the border and we went through and 20,000 we sent back because they're 15 to 18 years old and they got tattoos all over and they're part of gangs, get them out of here right away. And then if you have a certain number left, then there's many approaches. Some people say they have to be sent back too. That's where their parents are. you know, if their parents are back there, I say, that's where they should go too. What are we going to adopt these kids? They should be with their parents and try to get them reunited with their parents. And that's a message that will mean other parents will not send them. But if there's some hardship cases that have to be dealt with differently, that's not going to affect anything. You can't send a message to the world that we will accept everybody's poor children, because, you know, once they come here and get amnesty, their folks come in. Chain migration. It's ridiculous. We're going to collapse. We are right now importing poor. We have poor in this country who need our attention, who need jobs, who need a lot of help to get themselves up. And that's a full-time job, and we need to take care of our own first.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I just want to say that it's a true honor to meet you. My name is Rachel Boyd, and I go to California State University, Monterey Bay. I have a bit more of a personal question for you. As a young woman who is currently studying mathematics, but who has such a passion for this country and to get it back on track, I'm currently always told by people that you chose the wrong degree, you can't do this, because I haven't taken the expected path as many of the other individuals in this room have. And I was just wondering what your advice would be for a young conservative woman as myself, because I know that you too have, you know,
I have a
background in mathematics.
I did only math, right? Yeah. Through college, got a master's degree in mathematics, taught math at high school level, loved math, taught all my kids math. They never studied, so I had to teach them myself. Follow your heart. If you love math, there's not a lot of people that can do it. It's an extremely impressive degree, extremely impressive. I got to tell you, I became Treasurer of the United States, all right, at 32. And it was because of math, because the math took me into accounting. I was very good at numbers. This is no problem. I'll learn a little accounting. Got into accounting, became the controller of Ronald Reagan's Political Action Committee, and then the treasurer of it. Went to school at night, did some accounting courses to see what I'm doing, and became Treasurer of the United States. Now, I went on Jane Pauley morning show as Treasurer of the United States. You know, my name's on the dollar bill. And she says, well, you have a beautiful signature. Is that why you got the job? My signature? What? Oh, I mean, they're not all bright on TV. I'm thinking, my signature, I got the job. You know, I was taught Palmer penmanship, so I have very nice handwriting. But that's not why I got the job. But I got to tell you something. In all the interviews, as soon as they said, I have a master's in mathematics, check off smart. You know, I mean, they never even questioned whether I could do it, because they figured, you did math. Well, I might not know what I'm doing in this new job, but I got the job because they assumed I was very smart. I was different. I had something different that impresses people. That's not a bad thing on your resume. And as for going from that, I mean, you can go as a master's in math, you can easily get into the accounting department of a campaign, because they know you're adept. I mean, there's many opportunities. And also, you don't need all people, don't have to be lawyers or political science majors. I remember someone came to me in one of my campaigns, said, I have a master's in political science. And I wanted to say, so? You know nothing about a campaign. Give me somebody with 3 years campaign experience. Because campaigns are not what's written in the books. It's not theory. It's out there getting your head beat in and talking to people and trying to persuade them is something that you should be doing on college campuses now. Is far more important than what you learn in class. It could be interesting, but it's not what translates into a good campaign manager or consultant. Experience does. So you have the whole world open to you. And I say pursue that math fully and get that degree, because you will, no matter what interview you have, they're going to look down and say, math, huh? They're going to look at you in different eyes. I'll tell you, I carried that. I never used math for a job except the math teacher, but I'm telling you, it got me doors opened.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Yes.
Hi, I'm Cole. I'm from Washington, D.C. So the great economist Milton Friedman, who was one of President Reagan's closest advisors.
Certainly was.
Was a fan of heavy legal and actually illegal, interestingly enough, immigration. The Congressional Budget Office, the Wall Street Journal, both predict that the comprehensive immigration reform bill that was passed on a bipartisan basis in the Senate would reduce deficits, increase GDP, all sorts of good economic indicators. Additionally, the Republicans got shellacked on the Hispanic vote in 2012. Some people, such as your brother, think that we should, as Republicans, should squeeze an ever larger portion out of the ever smaller percentage of the white vote in America. Some believe that immigration reform...
A numbers guy.
Some believe
What's
that,
your question?
I'll also be studying math. So my question is, why not amnesty?
Oh, my gosh. The cost of amnesty would be enormous. We're talking billions and billions. Immigrants today cost us, illegal immigration today is enormously costly to our communities, enormously costly. If you look in the prison systems, they're packed with illegal immigrants, enormous costs there. Schools, we're taking care of the schools. Hospitals actually had to close in the southwestern part of our country over the years because they could not afford all the people who were coming who could not pay, and the government didn't subsidize it well enough. So they actually closed hospitals. What impact did that have on the Americans living in the neighborhood and in the communities? I talked to one lady whose father was a heart had heart problems. She now drove 2 hours to the hospital. She was terrified all the time something would happen. She wouldn't be able to get to a hospital. She used to have one in just within 10, 20 minutes. So this has an enormous impact. The amnesty. You pass amnesty for whatever you choose, 15 million or 10 million or 12, however you draft it. We will have 30 million illegal immigrants in this country in 20 years, and there is nobody in their right mind who thinks that is a good economic decision. There is nobody. And what happens? What jobs are they taking? Who are the neediest in this country? The neediest in this country are unskilled workers, and they are highly unemployed today, highly unemployed. And who are we bringing in to compete with them? Our own needy people. We're bringing in unskilled illegal immigrants and also legal immigrants to compete with the neediest. They're not competing with us. They're competing with the neediest people in this country, and they're being kept down and unable to climb up that economic ladder because of the terrible, terrible, tragic consequences of the policies in Washington related to immigration. There's, you know, I know what Milton Friedman talked about. I know there's a lot of Republicans. I fought that amnesty bill that George Bush supported, and actually we won because of the American people were so opposed to it. People are paying the price of illegal immigration, and it's huge across this country. And that is why you have local people, local mayors and county chairmen and senator and governors who are taking very tough positions against illegal immigration because the federal government refused to do. They see the consequences. Do you know in county after county that takes tough position on illegal immigration from down here in Prince George's County to Prince William, I think it is, all the way to Arizona, one-third drop in crime. One-third. I think that would be an important thing for a mayor. Pass these really in one-third crime, gone. No. Anyone who suggests it's theory that tells you that illegal immigration is a good thing. And I say to you, I got a good idea. You think we should increase the people come into this country? You think more people should come? Then why don't you do it the right way? Why don't you go to Congress and tell them instead of 1 million, 1.2 million a year, which is the most generous in the entire world, why don't you raise it to 2 million, 2.5 million? Make certain the people coming here are doing so illegally. And then, legally. And so, respecting our laws. And then on top of that, why don't we bring people here that have marketable skills, so we don't have to, taxpayers don't have to pay for them and their families. No, let's do it the right way. And you know why they don't do it? Because they're gutless. They know that if they ever supported a bill that increased legal immigration, they'd lose their seats. So they go and have a blind eye to the illegal immigration and take care of their corporations so they get cheap labor. Nope, nope, you'll never get me down that road. Yes, sir.
Thank you for speaking today. My name is Spencer Brady, and I'm a student at the University of Texas. I was just wondering, as a pro-lifer, what's your counter to the argument, like it's an economic argument, that abortion, when it's legal, decreases violent crime in cities, such as like the one made in the book, Freakonomics?
I mean, it is just such an outrageous statement. Just consider this. They think, you have a problem. So instead of solving the problem of violent crime, which is a serious problem, and people know how to do it. There's a lot of cities in this country that are free, virtually, of violent crime, and it's very low, and they have systems in place. Instead of doing that, we'll just wipe out the kids that might become violent criminals. We'll just wipe them. Well, what kind of, I mean, that sounds a little, like a Hitler kind of position, We'll just take care of the ones that we think are not going to. Well, why don't we take care of all the people that are disabled, too? Anybody that has bad genes, we'll just wipe them out and then see who else can we wipe out. No, the thing is, this is what the issue is. We do have issues in inner city, serious issues, ones that have not been properly addressed, in my opinion. And they should be addressed. What about the lousy schools in inner city? What about that? Why don't we have more choice in inner city? I talked to Donna Brazil, who's a dear friend of mine, African American, and I said, listen, I'll work with you. I'll go with you. Let's tell them we have to have choice in D.C. These parents are desperate for different opportunities instead of going to the terrible schools that do the district, and they can't do it because it'll offend their teachers' union. Okay, so now, okay, what we do is we have bad schools and we have families that have completely broken up, and so now we'll just abort their children and won't have to deal with them. I would say that's just, well, it's certainly a racist position, and I just think it's an inhuman position, an immoral position to take. And I think the key here is everybody deserves a right to life. That is a high road. That's an honorable position. I'm going to fight for the life. Now, if the life is one that is a troubled life, if the young lady is distraught, she's 15 years old, doesn't know what to do, she might only not have the kind of support from her parents, all right, then we need to counsel her. Is she not in a position to raise the children? Would you like us to help you find good parents for your child? Then you'll know you fought for your child and you did the best for your child. That gives a person great pride that they did what's right for their kid. Great pride. It's something that gives you enormous feeling. If you never want the child to find you again because maybe circumstances would be embarrassing, fine. If you want to have contact, fine. But we will make certain we work with you. That's what the pro-life movement does. They have counseling groups across the country. Do you need someone to talk to the school for you? Because they might throw you out of your housing, or they might do you need housing? Do you need a place? Do you need any medical? We should be there to help people. And then once the child are born and they want to keep the child, then we're there to help them get training and an ability to take care of their child. That's the thing to do. That's what raises people up. They see goodness in the heart of others who are there to help them. They learn how to be a good parent, or they learn either by giving up the child to adoption or by figuring out a way to care for the child. To destroy the child, I just think you should challenge anyone who gives you that position as to really ask them what is in their heart that they just don't want to deal with the difficult problems of life, so we'll kill them off. What about bad kids at 6 months? What about, you know, children that have real issues? I mean, that's what the next step is. We eliminate them before they're born. Why not eliminate them the first year? You know, mother has 10 kids. There's a rat-infested home. This is terrible. You know, these kids can never have a good life. Why don't we kill a few of them? I mean, that's just the next step. I'm not being radical. I mean, that is no grounds to take the life of a child. You ask them, do you believe it's a child? You believe this is a child? Who are you to pick? Who's going to? There's great Americans that have been born in terrible circumstances, raised themselves up, and have great stories to tell. That's what you have to do. You give them a path. Thank you very much. Yes.
Hi, Savannah from Hillsdale College. And this is more of a personal question, but you were so successful at such a young age, working as a treasurer for Reagan. Just, I was wondering if you had any tips for us going into workforce soon of how we can become respected even at a young age and like work our way up in the business and political world.
That's a great question. I was very successful. It's been downhill ever since. But, you know, when you're treasurer of the United States at 32, where do you think you're going? But, no, I've had a great life and enjoyed it just immensely. I think my advice, and it's to all of you young people, there's over the years, it wasn't true in my early campaigns with Reagan, but I saw it extremely evident in later campaigns. And so this is obviously a movement amongst what is taught in colleges and all of great attitude. A lot of young people come in and they have this attitude, like, I have a degree in political science, so why am I stuffing envelopes? I need to be in the policy department. You know, like, I don't answer phones. I have a college degree. Like, I answer phones if they're ringing, and I'm the campaign manager, so you better the heck answer the phone, you know? That you don't have a campaign where the phone rings more than 3 times, not a good one. And so it's this attitude that I shouldn't get lunches, and this is a story I'm going to tell at lunch, is I remember I was desperate, you know, as a campaign manager of an underfunded campaign, which seems to be always my case, you don't have any time. You get there in the morning, and you work till 7 at night, go home and see the kids, and you start working the phones at about, you know, 10 when they're asleep. And I would go, I'd raced in this room one day, and I saw a young lady there, and I just said, please, could you go get me some lunch? I don't care. Here's $5. Just go get me a sandwich. She was offended that I would ask her to get me lunch. Well, I wasn't trying to offend her. I was trying to get something to eat, you know? This was very simple. And so I just said, okay. She felt I put her down. Okay, never mind. So I found a guy in the mailroom, and I said the next time, could you get me lunch? And he raced down. He's cool. What else? You want something to drink? Okay. And every single day after that, he came by my office. I'm going to lunch. You need anything? Now, I'm telling you, when my brother flew into town, you know who picked him up? That guy. You know, he loved my brother. Hey, let him have some one-on-one with the candidate, okay? If a job was going to open up near me, I was going to hire him. That's my message. Every job you have, you're part of a team. And you got to play part of the team. You do what's necessary. If people are working late, you go in, you say, can I help you? Can I help you? Is there anything I can do to make this? Because that's what people need. There's time of crisis. They want to know it's the go-to guy. That's the key. And so forget all the attitude. Don't think that you're above or better. Just think you're part of this, and you want to respect those around you. You want to help them. You want to do whatever you can, and they will recognize you and respect you for that. Kill the attitude and be as much as you can. Get the work done. Hope that helps. Yes.
Thank you for coming. My name is Joel McIntyre from Central Washington University. Also known as Paul Ryan. My question to you is, you said lately leadership in Washington, D.C. has increased, maybe a little, maybe a lot. I'm wondering if you could attach some names to that statement.
Well, I'll tell you. You know, my man, Ted Cruz, gets a lot of grief. I love Ted Cruz. I love Rand Paul.
Yeah.
I think these are people, Senator Lee from Utah. Yeah. Outstanding. These are people who sit and they come together and they say, okay, we got to stop this. How do we stop it? You know, how can we figure out? They don't care that half the Republican leadership is like, oh, we can't do anything. We can't talk about this. I mean, they're just saying, well, how do we do this, okay? And they do something and everybody says, oh, no, this is terrible for the party. But what they're doing is they're establishing for America that there's people fighting. They're not winning all the time. Ted Cruz took a hit for running a point on the closing of the government last year. And I just was beside him the whole way. I said, this is what we need, is people who are willing to take the hit. He may have lost all opportunity. At the time, he might have considered lost all opportunity to run for president because people were so mad at him. Did you think that made any difference? He said, this is the right thing. We got to send a message that we can do this, that we are not going to take this, that we'll fight right up to the end. And then at the end, he said, okay, this is it. I did the best I can, and now I'm going to turn around, and we're going to come back another day, okay? He lost, but who cares? He fought. Too much goes on in this town. We do not even fight. You know, with Ronald Reagan, this is a lesson I learned. He ran in 1980. His biggest plank was cutting taxes. He's going to cut the size of government. He had an economic plan. He said one-third were cutting taxes, one-third. One-third? This is a little huge. And so he gets into the White House, and he goes up, and they came back, and they said, they're going to give you a 10%. He had his guys up on the hill, 10%. He said, 10%? I said, a third. They said, yeah, but the 10% is huge, you know, because it's a Democratic House. He said, not totally unacceptable. His own people were saying, look, this is really good. This would be a good compromise, first step. He went out to the American people. I promised a third. I need your help. Call Congress. Tell them a third. It got up to 15%. They said, this is unbelievable. Take it. No, I'm not taking it. I told him a third. He fought, closed the deal 25% across the board, marginal. Okay? That's huge. My point is, we have some fighters. We have some people not worried about their reputation, much more interested in turning this country around. That's the kind of leaders that we need. That's true leaders willing to put their own fortunes, etc., on the line, speaking up for those things they believe, inspiring other Americans to get into the races because there's people back there they truly are inspired by and want to help. And we need more of them, and that's what I need all of you all to be in short order. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you. Thank you very, very much.